Good morning. This is the time and place for the Planning Hearing Officer hearing for December 7, 2011. My name is Roger Kiesel, and I will be conducting the hearing as hearing officer. We have two cases today, and relevant exhibits are posted on the panel located directly behind me. The two cases are a conditional use permit case and a variance case, both for the same address. I would like to mention a second case listed on the agenda at 604 Cavanaugh Road, which was a setback or a standards and setback variance case, will be continued. We're not sure of the date, and everybody will be re-noticed regarding the hearing. As I mentioned before, there is one variance on the agenda today. Under provisions of Title 30, Chapter 30.43 of the Glendale Municipal Code, a variance shall be granted if four required findings are present. These findings are as follows: that the strict application of the ordinance would result in practical difficulties or unnecessary hardship inconsistent with the general purposes and intent of the ordinance. The second finding is that there are exceptional circumstances or conditions applicable to the property involved or to the intended use or development of the property that do not generally apply to other properties in the same zone or neighborhood. The third finding is that the granting of the variance will not be materially detrimental to the public welfare or injurious to the property or improvements in such zone or neighborhood in which the property is located. And then finally, that the granting of the variance will not be contrary to the objectives of the ordinance. The conditional use permit, there is one conditional use permit on the agenda today. Under the provisions of Title 30, Chapter 30.42 of the Glendale Municipal Code, a conditional use permit shall be granted if four required findings are present, and they are as follows: that the proposed use will be consistent with the elements and objectives of the general plan. Second is that the use and associated structures and facilities will not be detrimental to the public health or safety, the general welfare, or the environment. The third is that the use and facilities will not adversely affect or conflict with adjacent uses or impede the normal development of surrounding properties. And then finally, that adequate public and private facilities are or will be provided for the proposed use. Additionally, since the requested conditional use permit is for a new single-family house in the hillside, the findings need to take into consideration the Hillside Development Review, Chapter 30.11.040A, and those considerations are as follows. The first one is development shall be in keeping with the design objectives of the Glendale Municipal Code, the Hillside Design Guidelines, and the Landscape Guidelines for Hillside Development, as now adopted and as may be amended from time to time. The second, development shall be compatible with the surrounding neighborhood in terms of size, scale, bulk, mass, roofline orientation, setback, and site layout. The third is site plans shall show preservation of prominent natural features, native vegetation, and open space in a manner compatible with the surrounding neighborhood, minimizing alterations of terrain necessary for development. The fourth is site plans for development of property on steep slopes shall take into account the visual impact on surrounding properties. And then the final, the architectural style and architectural elements of infill development shall be compatible with the surrounding neighborhood. Findings. If the findings presented in the application at the hearing meet the criteria just described, the hearing officer can either approve or impose conditions for approval on the case in question. If the findings of fact are not evident, then the request will be denied. Public notice. Notice of this hearing was accomplished by the use of public notices, which were mailed out to property owners as well as applicants located within 500 feet of the subject property, physically posted on the site in question, and placed in the local newspaper. The hearing will proceed as follows. First, I'll read the description of the application or request. I'll read the reports from other city departments and other letters or communication from interested parties. Then the case planner will make a brief overview of the case, giving analysis and making a recommendation. The applicant will be asked to come forward stating both name and address and will be asked to present his case within 15 minutes, a 15-minute time limit. Others in support or in opposition of the project will be asked to come forward to speak, again clearly stating both name and address within a 3-minute time limit. Finally, the applicant will be given the opportunity to make closing comments if desired in response to testimony given by preceding speakers with a 5-minute time limit. excuse me. The case will then be closed and taken under submission. Decision. After the hearing, the decision will be prepared in writing and will be in the form of a letter sent to the applicant and all persons who responded to the public notice either either by speaking at the hearing or by submitting written notification. The date of the decision will be the date appearing on the letter. Appeals. Under the appeals provision of Title 30, Chapter 30.62, the Glendale Municipal Code, the decision may be appealed to the Planning Commission within 15 days of the decision date. Anyone wishing to appeal may obtain forms and brochures on the procedures from the Building and Safety Section, Permit Services Center, located on the same floor as this building. Speakers cards. If you wish to speak, please write your name and address on one of the speakers forms, which have been provided by the front door, and submit it to the planning assistant. Official proceedings of the zoning administrator's hearing are recorded on tape as part of the public record. Begin with the calendar. I'll just state again that the case at 604 Cavanaugh Road is being continued. We're not sure of the date, and everybody will be re-noticed regarding this. And then we'll start with 1505 Wellesley Drive. It's a conditional use permit, 2011-007, and variance case number PVAR 2011-002. The project description is the applicant is proposing to construct a new two-story, 1,568-square-foot single-family residence with an attached two-car garage on a lot less than 80 feet wide, measured 15 feet from the front property line. The lot is 3,550 square feet, where a minimum of 7,500 square feet is required for lots subdivided prior to 1986. In the R1R zone, floor area, District 3, located at 1505 Wellesley Drive, described as a portion of Lot 21, Block F, Track 5138. The project would require grading involving both cut and fill in order to enlarge the existing building pad to accommodate the proposed residence. The proposed amount of cut and fill totals 210 cubic yards. The existing residence will be demolished, I think it already has, as will the retaining walls. While I'm remembering, before we proceed, the public notice that went out transposed the variance and conditional use permit request. The standards variance is for the lot size. The conditional use permit is for the lot width, and those were transposed in the hearing, so just to clarify that. Okay, let's comments from other city departments. Okay, from Public Works Engineering, there are some standard comments, but there are also other case-specific requirements. No retaining walls or any portions of its footings, foundations shall be constructed within the public right-of-way. The second is the unpaved portion of the parkway between the property line and the back of the existing curb shall be landscaped and irrigated to the satisfaction of the Director of Public Works. Integrated Waste just have standard comments. GWP Electrical Engineering just had standard comments. And that was it. All right, so let's move on to the presentation by the case planner, Mr. Gabriel Reza.
Good morning, Mr. Kiesel. Good morning, members of the public. The site is a 3,550-square-foot lot with a partially demolished single-family dwelling that was built in 1925. There are no protected trees on site or within 20 feet of the property. There are no blue line streams or primary or secondary ridge lines located near the subject lot. If I may approach the board to walk the hearing officer through the project.
That would be fine.
Okay. Mr. Kiesel, we have here the site plan that shows the overall site planning of the site and the two new retaining walls that will be built alongside Wellesley Drive. The overall site planning is consistent in the location that the previous residence was, and this site plan displays that in color. We have here the garage plan, the first floor plan, and the second floor plan. Elevations have been provided to give a sense of what the design will look like. This application still has to go through the design review board. At that time, story poles will be required to display the overall massing and basically to depict where the volumes will be that is subject to design review board approval. Sections have been provided. As you can see that this is a staggered two-story home by definition. It will give the appearance of a three-story home, but it is not by code. Two volumes are what will be on top of each other and will not be a three-story home by code requirement or code definition. A cut and fill map has been provided. A combination of 210 cubic yards will be cut and fill moved around on that property. And then a supplemental retaining wall sheet has been provided to note that all retaining walls on site will meet the zoning code standards.
Is the existing retaining wall in the back there?
Correct.
It's retaining wall shown?
Yes, it is there.
That's
it's covered, I believe, with vegetation that's partially there. I believe will remain as.
So, Mr. Kiesel, as you noted, that there are two applications, actually two requests for this application, a variance first and then the conditional use permit. I'm going to start first with the analysis of the variance. Adherence to the standards and of the ordinance denies the applicant reasonable use of the land given that the proposed residence is comparable in size to the surrounding properties and previously constructed residence at 1,500 square feet. The proposed project will meet all other provisions of the zoning code in terms of setbacks, lot coverage, floor area ratio, landscaping, and parking requirements. The applicant cannot acquire neighboring properties to increase the size to a minimum of 7,500 square feet required by the zoning code because the adjoining lots have been developed with single-family residents and have existing substandard lots as well. The option to pursue a lot line adjustment among the adjoining properties would not be possible. In this regard, the property will continue to exist as an infill lot, and the owner is proposing to develop a moderately sized dwelling that is proportionate in size to the surrounding neighborhood. Granting the variance will not be detrimental to the public welfare or injurious to the property or improvements in such the zone or neighborhood. The project will not require environmental review or request any other variances pertaining to the design or construction of the residence. Approval of the variance for the lot size will allow the development of the site, which is consistent with the surrounding uses and will not be contrary to the objectives of the ordinance. Now I'm going to move on and do the analysis for the conditional use permit. The proposed use will not be detrimental to the public health or safety and general welfare of the environment. The proposed residential use is considered low intensity and is consistent with other adjoining uses. However, the construction of the proposed project will involve minimal grading at 210 cubic yards, which is substantially not much grading in relation to other projects that we've seen. Given that the area is established in an established community, this has been developed for many years, public and private utilities have been in place and will be available for the proposed development. In summary, to deny the property owner the right to develop in this lot solely based on lot width would be inconsistent with the original purpose and intent of the subdivision. In summary, staff recommends approval of this application with six conditions as noted in the staff report. The applicant is in the audience to answer any questions, and that concludes my presentation. I would be happy to answer any questions that you have at this time.
Thanks, Gabe.
All right, I'll call the applicant up first, Vic Karanfilian. Can you state your name and address, too? Thanks.
My name is Varkas Vic Karanfilian. I currently reside at 1500 Columbia Drive, Glendale, California.
Okay. You've got 15 minutes to make your case for both items.
I'm going to start off by stating, even if we don't get an approval, the retaining wall that you were mentioning in the back is in proper shape, but the retaining wall in the front is tilting toward, it's one, it's on the sidewalk, public way. Two, it's tilting forward, so eventually it's going to collapse, so we're going to have to do some sort of development at some point in time when it collapses and causes a mud to come down the street.
Okay. Dirt. But you said that the rear retaining wall is there and it's in good shape.
Correct.
Okay.
Besides that, as stated, for the variance, within 500 feet of this lot, 74% of the lots have areas less than 7,500 square feet and would require the same exact variance if they were developed currently with the current rules. So that in itself shows that it's a developed area and there's really no reason to deny it. And as stated previously, I guess I'm repeating myself now, okay. There's already sewer lines going, there's already public electrical has been ran, and residence has been there since 1925. Due to neglect of the previous owner, it got yellow tagged, and due to the banks not knowing what they're doing, they demolished the building without trying to fix it. As far as the conditional use permit goes, within 500 feet radius of the lot, 98% of the lots would have a width, width that's less than 80 feet, which would still require the conditional use permit as well. So the rules that are in place currently, I guess, don't apply to 98%
of the lots in the area.
So it shouldn't hinder us from proceeding forward. That's actually about it.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right. Barbara Livermore.
I'm Barbara Livermore, and I live at 1510 Columbia Drive, which is above and just to the left of them.
Okay.
And I'm all for Vic building his home. I'm all for that, so it's not that. What I'm concerned with, the thing I'm mainly concerned with, is the height of the building. And I noticed that on A6, the map of A6, which is in here, it's going to be 32 feet is the maximum height, and then you have, 3.5 feet that is going to be from the street level up. Is that the idea? According to the,
I'm sorry, 3.5 feet up from the street.
Well, there you have from the street level. There's a driveway and it goes 18 feet back. So I guess there's like a 3.5 foot kind of. It looks like on that map anyway on A6.
Okay. Why don't Why don't you finish speaking, and then maybe Gabe can answer.
And then above that would be then 32 feet. So we're looking at about 35 and a half, 36 feet. What I want to know is that is the hillside in the hillside ordinance. I believe that's the maximum it can go, the 32 feet. And I just want to know whether will there be inspectors out there to make sure that the builders don't go beyond that, because then it would be detrimental to our property.
Yeah, they're building inspectors will if the variance in the conditional use permit get approved, they get a building permit, and they proceed with construction, building inspectors go out periodically to check on a number of things, including the height.
And the height.
Yeah. If for whatever reason it turns out to be higher than it can be as required by our code, they'll need to come back. Well, they'll either need to make it comply with the height requirements, or they'll need to come back and ask for another variance.
Okay. And there will be story poles. I heard Mr. Reza said there'll be story poles, so we'll know the height of it, right?
The story poles aren't there to tell you the height. They're just you can look at it and sort of see the height, but it's also massing.
Oh, okay.
Just to help you visualize where the house is going to be.
Okay, so if we had a question about the height as it was going on, if we thought maybe the builders were getting a little too high with it, what department would we call on that? Who's in charge of that?
You could call Gabe, and he could work with the inspector.
Okay.
Or the inspection office. It's probably better to call Gabe.
Okay, but other than that, I'm all for you building your home. Thank you very much.
Do you want to?
Thank you for the comment. As I was looking at the plans, the way that the zoning code measures height is from when the building actually comes out of the ground to the very top of the finished material. Mm-hmm. And the way that the applicant has measured is correct, that he measured from the very bottom of the garage to the top of the finished material. There is a difference in elevation with the driveway slope, which is about 3 feet. So if you measure the distance from the curb, public right-of-way, to the very top of the ridge of the house, it turns out to be about 35
about
feet.
35.
You're correct. But the way that we interpret the definition of height, it's from when the building comes out of the ground. That he does meet. But to reassure you, I go out and inspect as well. That I can also put a note in there. The hearing officer can also condition that the applicant will be 32 feet and under.
That'd be great. Thank you so much.
Well, that's required by code.
Good.
So
okay, and I just want to make sure that
sure.
it's, you know.
Right. We will make sure. I will ensure that
okay, thanks a lot.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks for coming. Was there any other card? Did I? Okay.
I apologize.
Yes. All right. Is it Peachy Villanueva? Okay, great. Okay.
That's my name. And I live at 1504 Columbia Drive. It's just, you know, next door. My concern is about the retaining wall, my retaining wall at the back. So, yeah, we're right there at the back of the house that will be built. So is there any effect on the retaining wall that I have right now? Because I know that there is vegetation right there. But then when I purchased the house, they said that it's okay. I mean, you know, there's nothing that we can do with a... There's something that we can do, but then it has been there for a long time, and I didn't have any problem. So are we going to build a retaining wall or on that side?
I'm not sure of your question. Are you referring to the retaining wall
the back.
Located on the rear of the subject property?
Yes.
Okay. It's my understanding, and either the case planner or the applicant come back up, that retaining wall is existing. It's
nice.
A good shape, and they're not proposing to do anything with it.
Okay, so...
It will remain as is.
All right. And my other question is the same question as Barbara's.
The height?
Yeah.
Okay. Did we answer that one?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's fine.
Okay, good. All right. Anybody else wishing to speak? All right. Then why doesn't the applicant come back up? And if you have, you know, any responses to their concerns or if you want to add anything.
Very quickly about the retaining wall. They did come out and look at it, and as far as we can tell, it's in very good shape. So if for some reason the inspectors during the construction state that it needs to be reinforced or whatever, obviously we'll end up doing that. But as of right now, the way the house is built out, it's not going to affect the, it's not going to, we don't need to touch the retaining wall basically because it's already there and the house isn't, it's far away from it where it doesn't need to be touched at all in any way. And as far as the height goes, we kind of considered when we were drawing it out whether we should have that or not, the second floor, you would call it. And from what we calculated, it shouldn't affect either one of your views. So that's about it.
Okay.
And they will, we'll put up the story poles, obviously, so everybody will get to approximately see the height of it.
Yeah, that's also a requirement. So. Mm-hmm.
That's
okay.
Thank you.
I'm going to close the public hearing. I really didn't have any questions on the case. You know, at this point, I'll look at the CUP and the variance more closely, but I'm at this point inclined to improve the CUP and the variance. So I guess that's it, and the meeting is now officially over. Thanks.
If you have a comment or question regarding Channel 6 programming, call us at 818-548-4013. If you have a comment or question regarding Channel 6 programming, call us at 818-548-4013. If you have a comment or question regarding Channel 6 programming, call us at 818-548-4013.